हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू 13th लेक्चर ऑफ सरफेस केमिस्ट्री। सो प्रीवियसली वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द प्रिपरेशन ऑफ कोलोइडल सोल्स एंड मेथड्स ऑफ प्योरिफिकेशन। नाउ इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट सम प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ दीज प्रिपेयर्ड एंड प्योरिफाइड कोलोइडल सॉल्यूशंस। सो टुडे पॉइंट नंबर 5.4.6 properties of colloidal solution. So as mentioned earlier in the classification of colloidal sol, we discussed two different type of colloidal sols in the interaction between the medium and phase, and it was lyophobic and lyophilic sols. In lyophilic sol, all you have to do is just mix phase and medium with each other and you will get your colloidal solution prepared. But in case of lyophobic sols, it is hard to prepare because no interaction occurs between the phase particles and medium particles because they are actually repelling each other. So that's why we need some preparation method for them, and during this preparation they will get some impurities, and that's why we have to clear up them. So that's why we discussed about purification methods. In this point we will discuss about properties of prepared colloidal sols via different method. That means we will discuss about the properties of lyophobic sol, but these properties also are connected, or they are also the properties of lyophilic sols. That means these properties belongs to both of them, lyophilic as well as lyophobic. And on the other hand, previous two points, that means preparation and purification, it belongs to lyophobic sols. So first point is colligative properties. So we need to discuss what is colligative property first. In solution unit you will learn about it in detail, but right now let us discuss it in short. So remember we previously discussed about vapor pressure. When we put some liquid in a closed container, and if they are volatile, and most of liquids are more or less, they are volatile. Now volatile, that means they will evaporate from liquid state to gaseous state conversion. It is called volatility. So some of the particles of liquid will convert themselves into gaseous state. Okay, so top side we have gases, bottom side we have liquid state of the same molecule. So because of conversion we will get more number of gaseous particles, and that's why pressure increases, which is called vapor pressure of given liquid. Now let us assume we add some non-volatile solutes into them. Let us say initially we have pure liquid and it is water, and now we added non-volatile solutes, which is NaCl. Okay, so sodium chlorides are non-volatile particles, so they won't increase the vapor pressure, but they will actually decrease the vapor pressure. That means if we compare pure liquid and solution of NaCl, then vapor pressure in case of pure liquid will be higher, and the number of solutes present in it will decrease the vapor pressure because they will block the surface, because vapor pressure occurs when molecules are present on the surface. To understand that, assume this is the surface of liquid filled in this beaker. So what will be the initial observation? If you have pure liquid, suppose we are discussing the case A, in this case we have pure liquid. So all of the surface particles are of liquid, that means let us say water. Okay, so all of these particles are of our water molecule, and how can they get converted into gaseous state? Simply they will remove the liquid state and they will convert themselves into gaseous state. Okay, so this is evaporation. So if you have a particle or molecule inside the bulk, first this particle need to come up on the surface and then it can convert itself into gaseous state. No particle can directly jump from inside the bulk to gaseous state. It first have to move on the surface. Okay, Now let us assume we dissolved some non-volatile solute into it, like NaCl. So some of these surface particles will be occupied by NaCl. Okay. Assume out of initial particles, which was 11, 3 are now solute particles and it is non-volatile. So now less quantity of water is present on the surface, and that's why less quantity will evaporate. So it will decrease the vapor pressure. So as we increase number of solute particles, more and more surface will be occupied by this type of particle, and that's why lower will be the quantity of water, and that's why lower presence on the surface, and it will decrease the vapor pressure. Okay, so that's why non-volatile solutes decreases the vapor pressure of volatile solvents, and this decrease in water pressure is called lowering in vapor pressure. And lowering in vapor pressure is directly proportional with the added quantity of solute. That means it depends on the number of moles of solute. It do not depends on the nature. It depends number of particles. So lowering in vapor pressure depends on the added quantity of solute. So it is called colligative properties. We have such other properties like lowering in vapor pressure, elevation in boiling point, that means boiling points of liquids will increase. Then we have depression in freezing points, that means freezing point of liquids will drop down because of added quantity of non-volatile solutes. And this increment or elevation in boiling point or depression in freezing point, both of them depends on quantity added of non-volatile solute, obviously. Then we have osmotic pressure. We discussed about osmotic pressure. It also being affected with the added quantity of solutes. So all of these properties which depends on the quantity of solutes are called colligative properties. So these properties are also mentioned in this point as well. So colloidal particles being bigger aggregates, the number of particles in the colloidal solution is comparatively small as compared to true solution. Hence, the value of colligative properties like osmotic pressure, lowering vapor pressure, depression in freezing point and elevation in boiling point are the small order as compared to value shown by the true solution at the same concentration. So it means by the concentration is by mass, not by the number of moles. Okay, because colligative properties depends on number of moles. Now just assume we have a colloidal sole made up out of protein which has very large molecular masses, and let us consider it has molecular mass is equal to 1 lakh. Okay, and on the other hand we have urea which has molecular mass equals to 60. Now assume we have protein and urea, two different type of compounds, and we are using same quantity of both of them, which is let us say 10 grams of each. So we added 10 grams of protein and 10 grams of urea into the 1 liter of solution. So let us try to find number of moles of each, and so that we can compare number of particles of each. Now assume that the mass of protein is 1 lakh, and for protein like compounds we can say that it is comparatively low molecular mass. Okay, it will gain up to crores. So mass of urea, molecular mass will be 60 gram, and both of them are added in 10 gram quantity. So what will be the number of moles of each? So number of moles of protein, it will be 0.0001 moles, and for urea it will be 0.16. So as you can see, number of moles of urea is comparatively very high if we compare it with the protein. Now as mentioned earlier, colligative properties depends on the quantity of particles. So here as we can see, quantity of protein is extremely low in given mass, whereas quantity of urea is quite high. So we can say that in colloidal solutions, number of particles are comparatively less if we are using same mass, and that means number of particles will be less, and because of less quantity of particle, colligative properties will be less observable. Next is a Tyndall effect. If homogeneous solution placed in the dark is observed in the direction of the light, it appears clear. And if it observed from the direction at the right angle to the direction of the light beam, it appears perfectly dark. What it means? Suppose this is our solution placed on a table from side view, and from the top view it will be something like this. If you are observing it from the top side, it will be observed something like this. Okay, so we are observing our liquids from two different directions, and our light beam or light source is placed here. Okay, or let us say it is a laser light or beam of light moving towards the solution. So light beam from the top view, it will appear like this. Okay, so this is the direction of light towards the solution. Now we are observing our solution from two different directions. First is from the exact opposite direction of our light source. That means you are observing it from the here. This is the place of observant. First place, let us call it A. In second image, it will be here, exact opposite to the light source. Second direction, it is your actual direction right now. That means you are looking it from the let us say right hand side from the light source. That means you are perpendicular from light source. Okay, that means this is our observation direction B, and in second image this will be your observation direction here B. So in case of true solution, if you are looking it from the direction A, you can see clear light coming out of the solution, and our solution will appear clear, just like pure water, nothing is added into it. If you are looking it from the direction B, then no light beam will be observed. Okay, suppose all of this instrumentation is placed in a dark environment and only light source is here. So when the light beam is passing through this direction, you won't able to see light beams. It has to impact your retina or eye to observe it. If you're not if light rays are not coming towards your eyeballs, then you are not able to see the thing or even light. Okay, so in case of solution, you can only see clear solution from direction A, and if you are trying to observe it from direction B, nothing will be observed, or you are not able to see the light beam which coming through the solution. In colloidal solution, viewed in the same way may also appear reasonably clear or translucent by the transmitted light, but they show a mild to strong opalescence when viewed at the right angle to the passage of light. That means if you are perpendicular to the light beam, still you will be able to see that light beam passing through the solution. We are talking about colloidal solution. Okay, we will understand this point with the help of image, so it will be comparatively easier. So let us observe an image which can clear this point. So here is a simple example of a Tyndall effect. So we have three different bottles. First bottle, which is closer to the light source or laser light, but you cannot see laser light passing through it. In second solution, we can see the beam of light, and it is more clearer in third solution or third bottle. We can easily see light beam coming through this third beaker or third vessel. So why this type of situation occurs? Why in first bottle no path of light is being observed? On the other hand, in next two bottles we can see it. So first is a true solution. As mentioned earlier, if you are observing from the exact opposite, then you can see the light. But if you are observing it from the right angle or perpendicular to the light direction, then nothing will be observed. Second and third bottle, both of them contains colloidal salts or colloidal solution. Second bottle seems clear, but still it has some colloidal particles in it with lower concentration. In third bottle we have comparatively higher concentration, that's why light beam is more clear. Here is a more detailed example, as you can see, light beam is passing through the both of this beaker, but we can see it in one beaker only, because in one beaker we have true solution, in second beaker we have colloidal solution. And this is a Tyndall effect in nature. Sometimes we are able to see sun rays like this in a rainy season or in dusty environment or in early morning times. It is more visible because at that time particles of water or solid dust particles are mixed in atmosphere. That means we can say that it is an aerosol type of colloidal solution. Solid or gaseous liquid particles in gas medium. So why this type of path of the beam is illuminated by the bluish or different type of colored light? This effect was first observed by the Faraday and the later studied in detail by the Tyndall, and it is termed as Tyndall effect. The bright cone on the light is called Tyndall cone, as we can see in this image. So actually light passing through the solution or any other medium is we can say that it has cone shape. So but we are not able to see the light beam path, that's why we cannot observe it everywhere. But when it passes through the colloidal solutions, we are able to see the beam of light, because as we can see, particles of colloidal salts are comparatively larger in size, and their sizes are normally more than size of wavelengths of visible light. So that means visible light will interact with colloidal particles. In case of true solution, particles are very small and light beams cannot interact with them because they have lower size or less size than the wavelengths. So understand it like this way: first particle is a true solution particle and second one is a colloidal particle, and let us give some values to them. Suppose size of first particle is 0.1 nanometer, which is below the colloidal range, and size of second particle, which seems comparatively larger, let us increase size more, and let us say it is 10 nanometer in size, and wavelength applied on both of them, let us say it has wavelength equals to 5 nanometers. Okay, so obviously it is larger than the particle of true solution but smaller than the particle of colloidal solution. So when we are passing this light from both of these type of solution, because of less size of particle in true solution, light beams are unable to interact with them. They won't interact with the true solution particle and they will normally pass through them. But because of smaller size than the colloidal particle, they have to interact with them because they have shorter wavelength than the colloidal particle. And that's why it depends on the angle of collision. Suppose this is our particle. If light beam is colliding here, then it will move towards the upper side. If it is colliding with the exact straight line, then it will bounce back. If it is colliding here, then it will move downwards. And it also depends where light beam is colliding. That means if light beam collides here, it will generate more sharp angle. If collides here, again more sharp angle. If it collides here, it will move like this. Okay, so depending on the collision or interaction with the colloidal particle, light beam will scatter in different direction, and because of this scattering we can observe beam of light from any direction. So this is the reason why we can see the beam of light in colloidal solutions, because it scatters light, and that's why it is visible from all the direction and it generates Tyndall cone. So the Tyndall effect is due to the fact that the colloidal particle scatters light in all the direction in space. This scattering of light illuminates the path of beam in the colloidal dispersion, and that's why we can see the Tyndall cone. So Tyndall effect can be observed during the projection of picture in the cinema hall. Due to the scattering of light by the dust and smoke particles present there, Tyndall effect is observed only when the following two conditions are satisfied. First, diameter of dispersed particle is not much smaller than the wavelength of light used. And refractive index of the dispersed phase and dispersion medium differs greatly in the magnitude. In cinema hall, you can see the beam of light like this. This is due to the Tyndall effect or smoke and dust particles present in the air inside the cinema hall. Tyndall effect is used to distinguish between a colloidal and true solution. Zsigmondy in 1903 used Tyndall effect to set up an apparatus known as ultramicroscope. An intense beam of light is focused on the colloidal solution contained in a glass vessel. The focus of the light is then observed with the microscope and at the right angle to the beam. Individual colloidal particles appear as bright stars against the dark background. Ultramicroscope does not render the actual colloidal particles visible, but only observes the light scattered by them. Thus, ultramicroscope does not provide any information about the size and shape of colloidal particle. That means solvent particles are comparatively very small and they are not able to scatter the light, but colloidal particles are larger in size and they will scatter the light. That's why when we observe through the microscope, only light interacting with the colloidal particles will come towards the microscope and all the other light beams are not able to interact with our solvent or medium particles, and that's why they will pass through it and you will see some particles glowing like star with the black background, just like sky. Next point is color. The color of colloidal solution depends upon the wavelength of light scattered by the dispersed particles. The wavelength of light further depends on the size and the nature of the particles. The color of colloidal solution also changes with the manner in which they are observed or observer receives the light. For example, mixture of milk and water appears blue when viewed by the reflected light and red when the viewed by the transmitting light. Finest gold sole is red in color. As the size of particle increases, it appears purple and then blue and finally golden. Here is an example of gold soil having different size or concentration. So as we can see, with different concentration or different size of the particle present in the solution, it gives different type of colors. You can carry out the experiment with the milk. Use some milk and some water in a transparent glass and try to obtain transmitted and reflected light, and you will notice both of them have different colors. Okay, but keep in mind you have to use transparent glass and white light. White light, that means white LED light, will be good. If you are able to do that practical, then please do share image. So try to do the practical yourself, and all the requirements are easy to obtain by you. Milk, water and white light source. Okay, all of them are easily available. So try to do it yourself. It will be fun to do a practical yourself. And if you are successful, then do share with us in the WhatsApp group of ours. So next points will be discussed in next lecture. Next properties will be discussed in next lecture. And if you find any difficulties in the discussion we already did, don't hesitate to ask, and we will meet in next lecture.